Good morning and welcome to the 22nd meeting of 2022 of the Economy and Fair Work Committee. Our first item of business is a decision to take items 8 and 9 in private. Are members content? Thank you. The committee will now take evidence on the Companies Act 2006, Scottish Public Sector Companies to be audited by the Auditor General for Scotland, number 2, Order 2022. I welcome to the meeting Ivan McKee, Minister for Business, Trade, Tourism and Enterprise, who's joined by Ninian Christie, Solicitor, and Rebecca Winterstein, Head of Capital Investment, Scottish Government. And I invite the Minister to make a short opening statement.
Great, thank you, Convener, and I'm grateful for the opportunity to speak to this draft order, which relates to the audit of Scottish Futures Trust, or SFT. SFT is a non-departmental public body that acts as a centre for expertise on infrastructure. It works across the public and private sectors in Scotland to improve the efficiency and effectiveness of infrastructure investment. SFT was originally established as a public corporation and company in 2008, and as such it was audited by commercial audit firms. In 2011, SFT was classified as an NDPB by the Office of National Statistics. The majority of NDPBs are audited by the Auditor General for Scotland, and the Scottish Government and SFT have agreed that SFT should follow suit. This order will give the Auditor General the power to appoint an auditor to SFT in future. This change is not a reflection on SFT's previous audit arrangements and has no bearing on the functions of SFT. SFT has always been audited by reputable commercial auditors. SFT's annual accounts to date are available on its website and have been laid at the Scottish Parliament each year. This is an administrative change to bring SFT's audit arrangements in line with other NDPBs. In practical terms, we do not expect this to have significant impact for SFT. Audit Scotland could undertake the audit itself, or it could contract the audit to an external audit firm, such as the audit firms previously used by SFT. I am joined here by Rebecca Winterstein of Infrastructure and Investment Division, and remotely by Ninian Christie from the Scottish Government Legal Directorate, who will be happy to join me in answering any questions you may have.
Thank you. Do I have questions from members? Jamie Harcourt-Johnson.
Thank you much. Good morning. This was obviously set up in 2008. It became an NDPB in 2011, and that's 11 years ago. Why is the change only being made now?
Yeah, good question. We've been working through that process. So there's a number of bodies that had to go through this process, and we've been working our way through that. And of course, as a private company, it will have had contractual arrangements with commercial auditors that for a period of a number of years, it would have been worked through as part of that. So it wasn't the whole period, but that was a latter period. But effectively, it's just an exercise to bring things into line.
Okay, thanks. And obviously, it will now become under the opportunity for Audit Scotland to look. Do you know what their plans would be? Was that up to them in terms of deciding? Will they look perhaps retrospectively at previous accounts, or how will that?
In terms of retrospective, I don't know. I'll ask officials to comment on the technicalities on that. But I think there'll be a discussion with Audit Scotland around the best arrangements. It's quite likely that they might look to use a commercial audit firm to continue doing that, as has happened in the past, but that would be for them. But I don't know if you want to comment on the retrospective part.
The discussions we've had with Audit Scotland have all been forward-looking. They've not expressed any desire to look at accounts retrospectively.
Okay, thank you.
But those accounts will have been published, so they're available to be looked at anyway.
Okay, thank you. Do I have any other questions? I do have a member who is remotely joining us this morning. If Mr. Beattie, would you wish to ask a question?
Yes, morning, Minister.
Morning.
Just a couple of very, very small questions. First is, it's not clear from the documents here whether Scotland has formally agreed to take this on. I know that there's been lots of discussions about taking on additional audit functions, and presumably this is part of it. And linked to that, is there any impact on resources for Audit Scotland? In other words, are they going to need additional people, money, whatever, in order to carry out this audit? Is there a cost attached?
In terms of the discussion, again, officials can comment, but my understanding is that Audit Scotland will take this on as part of their role because it is an NDPB. And in terms of additional resource, I think that will be part of the overall discussion with them in terms of their, what resource they need to do their overall job. But as I said, it's quite likely that they may choose to use a commercial audit firm in that regard, which obviously would be far less resource intensive for them. But I don't know what discussions we've had in that regard.
We've kept Audit Scotland closely involved in this as we've been developing the order. They are perfectly content to take it on. And we have actually had no discussions with them about the costs associated with it. If you consider SFT currently use a commercial audit firm, if Audit Scotland also chose to use a commercial audit firm, the cost of the public sector is balanced.
Mr. Beattie,
Just to follow up on that, I mean, obviously, if they use an external firm to do the audit, as they do in some cases, there would be no additional staffing costs necessarily to Audit Scotland, but there would still be an absolute cost because, you know, there is a cost to carrying out the audit. Who absorbs that? Will it be absorbed by SFT? Will it be absorbed within the existing budget of Audit Scotland? And these are questions that would be useful to understand.
Yeah, well, I mean, at the moment, obviously, SFT would be paying for the commercial audit. In terms of which part of the public sector would pay for this going forward, I'm assuming it would still be SFT, but we can clarify that if it's helpful.
OK, thank you.
Jimmy Hargrove-Johnson.
Yeah, sorry to come back very briefly on this. Are there any other companies, any other NDPBs or organisations that are in a similar position that are kind of going through the system or you're intending to bring in?
That is a good question. Not that I'm aware of within my portfolio. There's already been one company, and I'm trying to look for the name. It's a rail business, I think, that was going through the same process. Scottish Rail Holdings Limited was the same process. I don't know if there's any others in the, across the piece.
Not that I'm aware of at this time.
Okay, okay, thanks.
Okay, thank you. Any other questions? Nope, if there's no other questions, we'll move to agenda item 3, which is the formal consideration of the motion to approve the instrument. And I invite the Minister to speak to and move the motion.
Moved.
Thank you. So as no member wishes to speak, does anybody want to? No. We put the question on the motion. The question is that motion S6M05863 be approved. Are we all agreed? Yes. Thank you. Thank you. The motion is agreed and therefore approved. And the committee will publish a short report of the decision that will be published soon. So I thank the Minister and his officials for joining us today. And I briefly suspend the meeting to allow for a changeover of witnesses. Okay, our next item of business is agenda item 4, which is consideration of a legislative consent memorandum on the UK Parliament Infrastructure Bank Bill. This is a UK government bill introduced in the House of Lords on the 11th of May 2022, which changes the law on devolved matters. I'd like to again welcome Ivan McKee, Minister for Business, Trade, Tourism and Enterprise, who is joined by Jeff Owison, Senior Policy Officer with the Scottish Government. And I invite the Minister to make a brief statement on the Scottish Government's position, and then we'll move to questions from members.
Thank you, Convener, and thanks for the opportunity to speak to you this morning about the Legislative Consent Memorandum for the UK Infrastructure Bank Bill. The UK Infrastructure Bank Bill was lodged in Westminster on the 11th of May, and the Legislative Consent Memorandum was lodged in the Scottish Parliament on 2nd September. First, let me say that the Scottish Government fully supports the aims of the UK Infrastructure Bank and they are broadly aligned with our own. Investment in infrastructure will be critical in meeting our commitment to a just transition to net zero and plays an important role in supporting regional and local economic growth. The purpose of the UK Infrastructure Bank Bill is to put the bank on a statutory footing by placing its objectives into legislation. It is intended to create transparency, accountability and governance. Of course, the UK Infrastructure Bank has already made its first investments and has been operating on a non-statutory basis since it was established in July 2021. We welcome the £22 billion of financing capacity and the advisory services that have been made available to local authorities. While our aims are currently aligned, the policy and landscape in Scotland differs from that of the rest of the UK with our Infrastructure Investment Plan, Global Capital Investment Plan and National Strategy for Economic Transformation, providing the framework for our policy priorities. Additionally, Scotland's climate change plan sets a target date for net zero emissions of all greenhouse gases by 2045, 5 years before the UK government target. The timeframes and nature of Scotland's transition to net zero will therefore be different to that of other parts of the UK, and therefore delivery will follow a different approach. We have therefore been seeking assurance that Scotland's interests will be suitably reflected in the design and delivery of UK Infrastructure Bank activity. The bill, as introduced, allows HM Treasury, by regulations made by statutory instrument, to amend the UK Infrastructure Bank's functions or the meaning of infrastructure. We, of course, appreciate that building in flexibility will allow the UK Infrastructure Bank to be responsive to changing priorities over the longer term without a requirement to update legislation. However, it also creates a future risk of divergence with Scottish Government priorities. There is a clear overlap between the strategic objectives of the UK Infrastructure Bank and the Scottish National Investment Bank, particularly with regard to tackling climate change and supporting regional economic growth. In order to ensure investments deliver maximum impact, we believe it's imperative that both banks are able to work together to identify and support appropriate infrastructure projects in Scotland. It's also crucial that Scottish interests are appropriately represented and there's an awareness of our economic context. We are therefore seeking an administrative mechanism, such as a memorandum of understanding between the UK Infrastructure Bank and the Scottish National Investment Bank, to support continued alignment in the approach over the long term. We have also asked for confirmation there will be no funding implications with respect to the Scottish budget. Convener, Scottish Ministers are clear that the UK Infrastructure Bank Bill has merit, but some of the clauses continue to cause constitutional concern. The Cabinet Secretary for Finance and Economy wrote to the Economic Secretary to the Treasury, John Glenn, offering in principle support for a legislative consent motion on 9th of June, but that letter made clear that legislative consent was contingent on the assurances I have outlined being provided. We remain in discussions with the UK Government about the assurances we have requested, and I'm hopeful we may be able to secure these, but we have still to receive a formal response. For now, therefore, I cannot recommend consent to the UK Infrastructure Bank Bill as it stands.
Thank you, Minister. The committee has a few questions. So you did say, so the government wrote to the UK government on the 9th of June looking for some assurances, and I think indicated there are some ongoing discussions. So firstly, on the Memorandum of Understanding proposal for the UK Infrastructure Bank and the Scottish National Investment Bank, do you think there is an understanding of the need for that? And I think you did say a mechanism such as, is there any other solutions that are being looked at in relation to the relationship between the two banks?
Yeah, well, the Memorandum of Understanding to provide alignment between the Scottish National Investment Bank and the UK Infrastructure Bank would be helpful to ensure that policy alignment is in place. There have been official-to-official discussions on this, my understanding that those are progressing in a positive direction, and there's an understanding or a recognition on the UK side that this would be a helpful move. So we remain hopeful that that'll reach a positive conclusion. But as I say, it's still in discussion on the detail of that.
We can maybe get progress there. I understand there's also been a suggestion, a request from the Scottish Government that an individual with relevant knowledge of Scotland's policy and project landscape should be included on the board or the investment panels, just to give that level of knowledge and expertise at the centre of decision making. Has there been any positive responses?
That is something we'd like to, from our perspective, would make sense. As I said, the reflection of Scottish interests and differences in the policy and economic landscape are important to reflect in the UK Infrastructure Bank. We've made that request. In that regard, we are less hopeful that there will be agreement from the UK side, but we continue to press the case because we think that would be a clear mechanism to ensure the Scottish interests were represented.
And is there other organisations that do use that type of model? I mean, could be used as an example about why it is important because the person, I mean, it's not a suggestion, the person doesn't have to actually be based in Scotland or be Scottish, it's somebody who has knowledge of the Scottish circumstances.
We have had similar discussions with UK government in other areas, but not always with success. So I think it's a mechanism that we think makes sense if they've got somebody explicitly who has that
Has there been discussions with other devolved nations? Will the UK Infrastructure Bank follow cover Wales and Northern Ireland? And is there similar concerns from them around?
There is from Wales as well. Wales is, just check, I'm pretty sure Wales is also not, they've not, Welsh Government has not recommended consent either on that basis.
And then you did mention concerns about Barnett consequentials. Can you maybe expand a bit more on those concerns and what assurances you're looking from the
Scottish? Yeah, I mean, clearly if there's money coming north as a consequence of things that the UK bank does, and they've already invested £200 million in broadband as part of their initial investments in Scotland, then we wouldn't want that to be caught up in issues around about the Barnett formula. So my understanding again is that there's been official level discussions on that and some progress has been made, and there's recognition that that needs to be that issue needs to be addressed, and again we're hopeful that that will be resolved, but there's been nothing clarified definitively yet.
And are there other areas where the UK government, because is this a common concern, are there other areas where the UK government are making direct investments or payments into Scotland that have concerns around Barnett consequentials?
Well, the
I'm thinking of Levelling Up Money or Green Ports or any of these other kind of projects that are happening.
Well, in Levelling Up, certainly, obviously, it's an issue in terms of the route that those funds follow. Certainly, I've not been as close to that, but certainly with regards to Green Ports, there's been quite a bit of discussion around about how that impacts Barnett or not. So I think it's very much on a case-by-case basis, and that's why we feel it's important to get some clarification and assurances with regards to this investment.
And can you maybe just tell us the timescales involved in this? So, you know, there's three areas you've kind of highlighted, and there's ongoing discussions with UK government and officials, but what is the kind of timescale? So when we really kind of need to know what the outcome of those discussions are?
I think through the rest of this year, there would be taking the bill through, so it's something we'd obviously want to get resolved sooner rather than later.
Is there are there other questions from members on Graham Simpson?
Yeah, hello, Minister.
Hi.
I just want to ask a bit about your request for an individual who has knowledge of Scotland. You're not necessarily asking for a Scottish Government representative. It just needs to be someone who knows about Scotland. So that could be a UK government person with knowledge of Scotland.
Well, it needs to be somebody that understood Scottish government policy and the context within which we operate. So that an understanding of our national strategy, economic transformation, our net zero activity, our global capital investment plan, our focus on infrastructure, and the strategic transport plan, etc. So somebody who understood that and was able to represent or make the case as to why or how the infrastructure bank's investments were aligned with those priorities.
Yeah, and you're not asking, or maybe you are asking, for you to have a prove who that person is, because that person could change, couldn't they?
Yes. Yeah.
So you are asking?
No, we're not asking. But see, the person could change. Yes. Yeah. Just a recognition that there was somebody on the board or the investment panel that had an understanding of those issues.
Yeah, and similarly for Wales.
I'm not quite sure if Wales have made the same case exactly.
Not sure.
Right.
Okay. We're here to talk about Scotland, of course. And the memorandum of understanding, is it your understanding that will get that?
There seems to have been positive moves around that, and there's a recognition that it makes sense, and obviously the details need to be worked through, but I think we're hopeful that that will reach a positive conclusion.
Yeah, OK. And back to what the convener asked about timescales. So in terms of timescales for this Parliament, we wouldn't be asked to take a view until sort of later in the year or early next year?
If we get these issues resolved to satisfaction, then we'd be returning with another recommendation at some point, which is that could be later this year or early next year. Yeah.
Okay, thanks.
Okay, do you have any other questions on this Michelle. It's just off the back of the other areas. In terms of the fact that there's money's been spent, and I mean, this may actually be a question really that lives with the Audit Committee, but how have there been any discussions about how money's spent by the UK Infrastructure Bank, how that will be actively scrutinised, audited, and aligned to the national performance framework, given that the Scottish Government is responsible for outcomes?
Well, it reinforces the point I've made about the UK Investment Infrastructure Bank having an understanding of the Scottish context, because the impact of decisions that they make on the National Performance Framework is clearly very central to the Scottish Government's priorities and the way we work in Scotland. In terms of audit of the impact of that, again, officials might want to comment, but it will depend, I suppose, very much on what the investment is. So we take the one at the moment on broadband, and clearly that, if it goes as planned, would have an impact on our broadband rollout aspirations and contribute to our metrics around about delivery of those. So it would have an impact there, and we obviously monitor that as a separate piece of work, but I don't know in terms of audit. Right. Okay. We can check and come back to you on the specifics on that.
I suppose I'm highlighting because obviously the suggestion of an MOU or having somebody represented will consider the kind of proactive upfront aspirations and whatever areas, but I'm also thinking about the reactive scrutiny element in terms of value for public money. So this is the two sides of the coin. So you can come back to us on that.
Okay, thank you. And can I just ask, I think the final question will be, so the memorandum of understanding to create alignment between the Infrastructure Bank and the Scottish National Investment Bank. And at the moment, the objectives for those two banks and institutions are quite similar. It's around net zero ambitions. And if I suppose that's what my memorandum of understanding is for. Could you see a position where they could start to diverge? There might be different priorities. But is that the purpose of having, is that one of the purposes of having the memorandum of understanding? Why is it important to have that there?
In terms of divergence of priorities, that's an issue, and that is one of the reasons why we'd want to have better processes for alignment, just to guard against that in future. But the memorandum of understanding is also to, I suppose, help ensure that the two institutions are working together where it makes sense to do so, and understanding they're not bumping into each other, for want of a better word, when it comes to supporting specific projects, because clearly if a project is looking for funding, they can be talking to a number of institutions or investors, and if the two banks understand how each other are operating in that space, then clearly it makes the process a bit more streamlined and efficient.
Okay. Thank you very much. That brings our evidence session on this LCM to a close, and I briefly suspend the meeting for a changeover of witnesses. Our next item of business, agenda item 5, which is consideration of a legislative consent memorandum on the UK Parliament Procurement Bill. This is a UK government bill introduced in the House of Lords on the 11th of May 2022, which changes the law on devolved matters. I'd like to welcome again Ivan McKee, Minister for Business, Trade, Tourism and Enterprise, who's joined by Julie Bain, a lawyer with the Scottish Government, and Alistair Hamilton, Procurement Policy Portfolio Manager with the Scottish Government. I invite the Minister to make a brief statement before questions from members.
Thank you, Convener. The Procurement Bill is intended to reform the regulation of public procurement, primarily in the rest of the UK. The UK Government is keen to present it as a Brexit opportunity, but this of course ignores the fact that in Scotland we were able to reform public procurement whilst being members of the EU. The Procurement Reform Scotland Act 2014 placed a sustainable procurement duty on authorities to consider the economic, social and environmental wellbeing impact of a procurement exercise in their area. And it increased transparency by requiring contracts to be advertised on one single portal and that authorities publish a pipeline of expected contracts. The Act also contained measures on community benefits, reporting and contracts for health and social care, all of which is compliant with EU rules. Where the UK Bill is most noticeably doing something different is in introducing new flexibility for buyers to design procurement procedures. It says this will allow for a more responsive procurement system, but will also mean that companies will potentially come across a new way of doing things every single time they bid, which will be different again from how contracts are awarded in the EU. We do not share the UK government's enthusiasm for dumping EU rules for the sake of being seen to be doing something. For the most part, therefore, this bill will have no practical effect in Scotland. There are three specific ways, however, in which it does engage with the LCM process. First, it seeks to regulate the procurement activities of reserved and cross-border bodies operating in Scotland. This mirrors the approach to scope and extent in the Procurement Reform Scotland Act 2014, which excludes bodies exercising reserve functions, meaning they are not covered by the sustainable procurement duty, for example. To that end, it's not unreasonable for them to be subject to this bill, but at present, I cannot recommend that Parliament consents to that, given the concerns we have with other parts of the bill. The second area in which the bill touches on devolved competence is in relation to cross-border procurement. Frameworks or similar agreements awarded under the new UK rules will not be compliant with the Scottish rules, and so devolved authorities in Scotland would not be able to use these arrangements. Similarly, UK bodies would not be able to use arrangements put in place under the Scottish rules. This is a practical issue which needs to be addressed because buyers from both sides of the border cooperate with each other when it makes sense to do so. The way in which it's addressed in the bill is unacceptable, however. The bill creates powers to address the issue through secondary legislation. Some of these are in devolved areas, and it confers on UK ministers without any requirement to secure the consent of Scottish ministers before exercise. And they are drafted very broadly, including a provision which would allow UK ministers to modify an act of the Scottish Parliament. And finally, the third area in which the procurement bill touches on devolved competence is in relation to powers to implement international agreements relating to procurement. And we agree that such a power is necessary, but the power, as presented, is too broad and is conferred concurrently on UK and Scottish ministers, with no requirement on UK ministers to secure the consent of Scottish ministers before it's exercised in relation to devolved matters. There is no justification for this, and I cannot recommend consenting to it. Convener, it's a matter of regret that the UK government didn't engage with us more fully before drafting of these elements of the procurement bill to work with us to arrive at a proposition that was acceptable. Had it done so, we could potentially have recommended consent. We remain in discussions with the UK government about its plans, and I'm hopeful that we may be able to secure some improvements, particularly in relation to the practical issue around cross-border procurement, but we're not there yet. So therefore, for now, I cannot recommend consent to the bill as it stands.
Okay, thank you, Minister. I'll take questions from members. Jamie Harcourt-Johnson.
Yeah, thanks very much. I just wonder if you could update us on those discussions with the UK government, what's been happening, when the next planned meeting, and also what level the meeting is, at official level or ministerial level?
Well, at the moment, meetings are at official level. It's ongoing. Officials can perhaps give you some dates if you require that. There's not been engagement at ministerial level. Of course, you could come and just change other ministers, so we're just establishing contact with them as we speak.
Yeah.
I don't have any specifics on that.
Yeah, engagement has been going on for a number of months with the UK government at official level. As the Minister said, particularly on cross-border procurement, it has been a constructive engagement, but we're not yet at the point where we have a proposal on the table.
Okay. And there are a number of LCMs we're looking at today. Would the intention be that there is ministerial engagement, ministerial level engagement on these LCMs and perhaps in a more general term fairly soon?
with regards to procurement?
Well, with regards to the LCMs that we've got here, plus a general meeting, as it were. And
I'm very keen to write to engage with UK government ministers as often as required. I wrote to my UK government counterparts when they took office in the last few days. We've got in the diary a base quad already, and there'll be other meetings happening which allow us to, across all of my portfolio, on a four nations basis, which will allow us to discuss these issues on trade and on tourism and all manner of things I'm responsible for, digital, etc. That's an ongoing process, and as those meetings start up again, then obviously this will be these will be discussed as part of that process.
Okay.
Thank you. Michelle Thompson?
I suppose I've got the same general observation as I relayed in the earlier session about how scrutiny will be undertaken and alignment with our priorities, whether it's in terms of fair work or conditionality or gender fairness, and both proactive upfront and reactive in terms of value for spend and alignment to the national performance framework. That's my first question, but my second question was, it'd be helpful for me in terms of the sense that the need, the powers are too broad, if you could outline some practical examples of where this would be a concern in terms of procurement processes, just to make your concern live. Thanks.
Yeah, well, on the first point, as I said, the current situation is that Scottish law places requirements on bodies that are in devolved areas, and bodies that are reserved or cross-body are not included in that, and this bill would cover them. So there is a different scope in that regard, if you like. In terms of the practical effects, I mean, I suppose it's like the problem we've got is it confers those powers, which, as I said, could allow UK government ministers to make changes to acts of the Scottish Parliament. So in that regard, it's pretty broad and could cover a wide range of areas, and that the concern, therefore, is that we don't know what it could impact in terms of it opens a door, and then what they choose to do with that would be a concern. So we see issues with that because of the way it's been drafted, because it confers those powers, it's, from our perspective, that's it's an unacceptable position to be in, where UK governments have got, UK ministers have got the power to be making changes to acts of the Scottish Parliament in that regard.
And just picking up then, to be clear, have you had any, I mean, obviously, I appreciate what you've outlined about behind the scenes and official level, but have any discussions in both of those taken place about this broadness of powers and specific examples within that? Is there any more colour you can give to that?
Well, there's been discussions ongoing. It's at official level, and I'm ready to engage with UK government ministers when they're in place and able to talk on this. The I mean, obviously, when they're taking a bill through Westminster, there's a whole range of aspects they're considering from different quarters. As it goes through, there'll obviously be amendments and so on and so forth they need to consider across a whole range of things. So we're part of that process of engaging with them to make them aware of our concerns, which I say we've done, and to address what they may be able to do about it. And if you look back in similar situations I've been involved in previously, when sometimes we're able to resolve those through ministerial discussion and sometimes we're not. But as we get to that next stage, then we'll obviously be talking about the implications of it directly with UK government ministers, and hopefully they'll recognise that they're able to make changes to the bill as currently drafted that that take account of those.
And going back to my first point then, I mean, we had an earlier session, but it'll be along in a different record. Will the discussions include any consideration of how procurement and the inaction of this bill will align directly with a national performance framework? I call your attention to the fact that the Finance Committee has asked that the UK government have cognizance of this because there's a specific measurable outcomes that the Scottish Government will be measured against, even if it's not directly linear. We appreciate the complexity of the budget and so on, but has any consideration been given to that, or would that in fact be an additional area concern for you?
As I said before, the procurement scope within Scotland covers the devolved aspects, and presently reserved and cross-border are not part of that that mechanism, or part of that, covered by that legislation. So it reflects the situation as it stands at the moment. At the moment, obviously, having responsibility for procurement, I'll work very closely with officials and others to ensure that the actions we take on procurement support our policy objectives, be that on community wealth building, sustainable procurement, more work going to Scottish businesses, more work going to SMEs, etc., etc. I mean, that's a relentless and ongoing process, and we look for every opportunity to take that that forward. But UK government procurement has been outside that that scope up to now, but then that effectively wouldn't change.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you, Fiona Hislop, do you want to?
The importance of procurement post EU exit, I think, has been recognised by everybody that there had to be legislation put in place. And in January 2022, the UK and devolved governments published the Common Framework on Procurement, which this committee, and I think everyone recognised, was a very practical, common sense way forward. However, the Scottish Government noted in their LCM that they've not been able to fully address their concerns with the procurement bill. So how has the common framework been operating in practice? Because everybody was looking to that as being the practical means by which there could be that sensible common sense cooperation.
Yeah, well, I mean, that cross-border cooperation on procurement is worth exploring it effectively at the moment. On either side of the border, organisations will put in place framework agreements with suppliers to enable them to make use of more advantageous procurement conditions, and organisations on either side of the border will leverage those agreements with supply base to best effect. So that situation already happens. There's agreements that will be created by Scottish bodies with the supply base that organisations south of the border will leverage, and likewise in the opposite direction. And part of the concern we've got as the bill is introduced, and one effect would be to close off that that cooperation because of the way the bill's drafted. So it's a concern that actually makes that process harder than it is at the moment. Do you want to comment on that, Alistair?
And just to add to that, in terms of the operation of the common framework, excuse me, the common framework has been operating on at an official level. We meet monthly with our counterparts, and there's a six-monthly liaison group meeting. We have expressed in that forum our concerns that the UK's approach to this bill isn't necessarily compliant with the common framework's principles in terms of respect for devolved competence. So that has been noted at that level. Working our way through this process is part of how that framework will be the test for how the framework operates in practice.
So my next question was about what amendments you really want to see for the LCM to be able to be consented to. And so therefore, you know, in terms of the impact on cross-border contracts, what changes would you need to see to the bill for you to be able to bring forward an LCM for consent, particularly in relation to that cross-border arrangement?
There's two clauses I think we can highlight, certainly clause 83, which gives UK government ministers powers, which is concerning in devolved areas with regards to implementation of international agreements. And clause 103 likewise gives powers to UK government ministers in regards to cross-border arrangements. So both of those are clauses that we think would need to be amended. Alistair, if there's any other aspects to that?
No, those are the two, Minister. In terms of making sure that there was a requirement there to seek or secure the consent of Scottish ministers before their operation, or perhaps in relation to clause 103, which is the cross-border procurement, putting the measures necessary to give effect to cross-border cooperation on the face of the bill rather than delegating them might be an alternative way forward.
So do you think this is more accidental mission creep as opposed to deliberate power grab? I mean, I'm trying to be generous here, just because obviously there's degrees of disagreement with LCM. I think the infrastructure bill looks a bit more straightforward, but this one, because it's so important, because it is procurement, we need to get it right. But is it something you think you can try and resolve at ministerial level to try and get us back on track with the common framework agreement?
To be honest, it's sometimes hard to tell the difference, and UK government has obviously got many... many people working within it, and a lot of things will come forward that perhaps could be written for different reasons and not fully appreciate the implications
right,
of them. So
yeah,
that's sometimes a situation, and sometimes that isn't the situation. As I said, I'm hopeful that officials will work their way through and be able to address that. But if not, as I said, minister-to-minister engagement would allow us the opportunity to be more direct about the issues we've got with this and how it could be potentially resolved. At that point, then it perhaps becomes clearer as to whether what the intentions are.
Okay. And can I just maybe ask
yes,
one?
Yes, go ahead.
Just more for clarification about how the procurement's working. So you talked about the Sustainable Procurement Bill and how in Scotland there's a desire, and this committee has also looked at it in its supply chain inquiry about how procurement can be used in a positive way, whether net zero, living wage, gender, different areas. So for reserve bodies, and I was thinking about the DWP in Bathgate, for example, my constituency, if it was conducting its own procurement. Now, obviously, a lot of that's centralised, would be part of UK-wide common frameworks, but if they were doing things more on a more local basis, would we be expecting them to be subject to the conditionalities that we would have, or is that going to be part of what should be happening in terms of those UK-wide common frameworks because it's the procuring agency is reserved? But what we don't want is for that then to be, the freedom that has been given to the reserved agencies on their procurement. We don't want that then to compromise what is done in devolved areas. Just sort of practical clarification.
Yeah, I mean, my understanding is that is the situation as it is at the moment. So in devolved areas, we can legislate for that and require procurement to follow certain processes, but for bodies which are reserved areas or cross-border at the moment, they're outside the scope of devolved procurement legislation, that would continue. So we have that difference at the moment, and nothing would change in this regard anyway.
Do we know what the volume of UK reserve bodies procurement is in Scotland?
That's a good question. I know that in Scottish procurement is around about £14 billion, and that includes local authorities, NHS, other public bodies, Scottish Government, and so on and so forth. I don't have a figure for UK government procurement within Scotland, but of course, it depends how you would look at that, either as UK bodies that are operating in Scotland and placing their purchase orders from an entity in Scotland, or you could be looking at UK government bodies as a whole across the whole UK that may be buying from Scottish suppliers. So there's a number of different ways to look at that, but I don't have
that. I mean, that would be interesting to know if you had that information to share with the committee, but I'm aware it's not specific.
I would suspect it'll probably be a broadly similar number, but I don't know for sure.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, this is probably a simple question that I'm just not, I'm misunderstanding what's before us, but you're saying that, so currently the situation is it's a reserved organisation or it's a cross-border, that won't change the way in which, so what does it change?
What it does do is because of the way it's drafted, it gives powers to UK government ministers to be able to change things that are devolved.
And I think, because Michelle and Fiona both kind of, so what would be a practical example of that?
That's the issue. As it's written, it basically says UK government ministers can make changes to things that they can't currently make changes to in a Scottish context. And that's pretty broad, but I don't know if you want to comment on any specifics.
Yeah, if you look at the power in Clause 83 to implement international agreements, the equivalent power for the UK ministers in relation to the UK Act, as it will be, is to amend the schedule to that Act so that international agreements are listed in that. Now, we need a similar power in relation to the Scottish regulations to update the schedule to the Public Contracts Scotland Regulations 2015. But the power as drafted is a much broader power for concurrently exercisable, which allows either UK or Scottish ministers to make provision to ensure equal treatment. Now, there are many different ways of ensuring equal treatment. Mm-hmm. So that would be taking that scrutiny away from the Scottish Parliament, potentially putting it in the hands of UK ministers. And also there's the Henry VIII provision in that as well, which would allow amendments to future acts of the Scottish Parliament.
Mm-hmm. Although the suggestion that we could have the Henry VIII powers, or that Scottish ministers should adopt Henry VIII powers in certain circumstances?
I think the only issue that Alice has commented on is with regards to updating. So if there's a new treaty was signed with someone else, you would add that to the list of treaties that need to be taken into account when you are taking for procurement legislation. That covers it in that regard.
Okay, thank you. I'd also like to thank the Delegated Powers Committee for the work that they have done on this that supported our questions this morning. Okay, it brings us to the end of the evidence session on this LCM to a close, and I briefly suspend the meeting to allow for a changeover of witnesses. So our next item of business, agenda item 6, which is consideration of a legislative consent memorandum on the UK Parliament Trade, Australia and New Zealand Bill. This is a UK government bill which was introduced to the House of Commons on the 11th of May and changes the law in devolved areas. So I'd like to welcome back Ivan McKee, Minister for Business, Trade, Tourism and Enterprise, Julie Bain, Lawyer of the Scottish Government, Alistair Hamilton, Procurement Policy Portfolio Manager, and we're being joined this time by Leslie Henderson, Team Leader, Food and Drink Regulation and Trade with the Scottish Government. I invite the Minister to make a brief statement on the Scottish Government's position, and then we'll move to questions from members.
Thanks very much, Convener. The Trade Australia and New Zealand Bill is a very narrowly focused bill, and whilst we have some wider and significant concerns about aspects of the free trade agreements with Australia and New Zealand, particularly in relation to agriculture, the bill is focused only on the implementation of the government procurement chapters of those deals. Amendments are needed to procurement legislation to extend duties of equal treatment to bidders from Australia and New Zealand and to make some minor amendments to procedural rules. The UK government has opted to confer a power on ministers to make these amendments. Like the power in the procurement bill that we've just talked about, this power is drafted too broadly and conferred concurrently on UK ministers as well as Scottish ministers, with no requirement on UK ministers to secure the consent of Scottish ministers before exercising it in devolved areas. And that is clearly unacceptable. But, Convener, while the bill itself is relatively narrow in its focus on the procurement chapters of these two agreements, it would be remiss of me not to say a few words about the agreements more broadly. And the Scottish Government has had no direct role in negotiations, and we are very concerned by the impact of both of these agreements. These concerns are particularly acute in relation to agri-food. The potential for imports to increase is huge. Australia currently exports 5,000 tonnes of beef to the UK each year, but the agreement will allow 35,000 tonnes in the first year, increasing each year after that. And of course, Australian producers do not have to adhere to the same animal welfare and environmental standards as Scottish farmers. There's a similar story in relation to the agreement with New Zealand, where access to the UK beef market will rise to 60,000 tonnes by year 15 of the agreement. There are almost no benefits in this deal to Scotland's food and drink sector. All that this deal achieves is to expose Scottish agricultural market to the most export-oriented food producers in the world. And to what end? UK government analysis shows that the deal with New Zealand will deliver a 0.03% benefit to UK GDP over 15 years, with the Australia deal contributing 0.08%. While at the same time, the UK's EU trade and cooperation agreement will lead to a contraction of UK GDP by 4.9% over that time period. Of course, economic self-harm of leaving the EU should come as no surprise, and it's noticeable and worth highlighting, Convener, that the EU has secured the same market access into New Zealand for its exporters as the UK, but at a much, much lower cost to its domestic producers. Convener, being outside of the EU and tied to a UK government hell-bent on reaching trade agreements at almost any price so that it can pretend that Brexit is working is an invidious position to be in. But it's a position we find ourselves in, and we must try to protect Scottish interests as best we can. The impact of these agreements will be felt throughout Scotland.
Just for interrupting, the committee are focused this morning on scrutinising the LCM. I do appreciate there are broader issues that you wish to highlight, but I think the committee are fairly familiar with the political discussion around
Absolutely, and it's hugely important, Convener.
Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you.
I'll now take questions from ministers. Maggie Chapman.
Thank you, Thanks very much.
Sorry, from members. Maggie Chapman.
Thanks very much. Good morning, Ms.
Morning.
Thank you for being here this morning. A similar question to the starting off for the others we've discussed this morning. What discussions have you had since the 13th of June, since the Scottish Government published its LCM with the UK Government? And do you see any progress being made on the areas of concern that you've highlighted?
Well, the areas of concern on this are broadly the same as we've highlighted on the procurement bill, and it's the power that it confers on UK government ministers in devolved areas. So there's been official level discussion on that, but not any discussion at ministerial level specifically on that point.
And I suppose is your hope the same, that you will actually be able to work something out on this, or is... Do you get the sense that your officials are meeting an intransigent UK official?
I'll let officials comment on that specifically, but as I said earlier, my experience on this has been sometimes when we engage at ministerial level, it resolves it, and sometimes it doesn't. Okay. But until you have the conversation, it's difficult to know where the UK government's position is on that.
Thank you.
Yes, it's a very similar issue to the equivalent power in the procurement bill. So we're meeting with Cabinet Office and DIT officials on this. They understand our concerns. They are thinking about ways in which they could be resolved, but we don't yet have an agreement. Okay. So it may arise, it may not.
Okay, thank you.
Do you have any other questions? Fiona has that one.
Yep. So there is an interplay between this LCM and the one we've just been considering on procurement. And although I think my colleagues might not want to dwell on the politics of this, there's an issue of not much gain, but potential vulnerability to Scottish suppliers from this agreement. So the issue then is on procurement. And to try and get this in a practical sense, clearly the UK government is responsible for the trade agreements, but the broad powers that have been set out in the procurement bill may undermine Scottish suppliers potentially compared to, for example, their New Zealand counterparts, in order to try and make sure that kind of trade agreement is carried through. So, for example, if there are procurement powers given to the UK government from the last bill, the procurement bill, on, for example, schools accessing lamb, for example, for the school meals, if there's a broad power for the UK government in the procurement legislation, that could actually undermine what we might be wanting to do in Scotland in terms of ensuring that, you know, then local authorities can access and be able to procure locally to help in the sustainability. So I'm trying to make this more real in terms of what the implications are. So nobody's disputing that the UK government has the right to do the trade agreements, and they may want to add subsequent ones on into the legislation, etc. The issue is the interplay with the broad powers of the procurement legislation, which is primarily at hand. Am I correct in my understanding? And if I'm incorrect about procurement of Scottish produce for Scottish schools being undermined by the procurement legislation, please correct me.
Well, you're right in the sense that the trade deal, as agreed by the UK government, obviously enables much more produce to come in from New Zealand and Australia than currently is the case onto the UK market. The concerns we have on the procurement bill and on this bill is the broad range in powers it gives to UK government ministers within devolved areas without having to seek the consent of Scottish government and Scottish ministers. So that's the area of concern. What they then do with that is then, I suppose, an open question, but it opens that door and gives them the powers to operate in devolved areas.
And just to add to that, the power in this bill is also a power to implement the Australia-New Zealand agreements as they may change in the future.
Uh-huh,
right. Which clearly we don't know what that might be.
Yeah. And I'm generous. I don't expect the UK government to undermine the Scottish supply chain, but obviously the problem is, without our consent or monitoring of it and scrutiny of it, things could happen by accident or, you know, rather than design. And then it's something that, you know, we're the duty bound Parliament that should be scrutinising these things. And obviously, if they can do it for future legislation without it coming to us, even just to check, that's the problem of the door being open for unintended consequences. Is that a fairer representation of the situation?
Yeah, that's part of it. And if you look back through the process for negotiation of trade deals, the paper that we published back in 2016, I think it was, that highlighted, or shortly thereafter, that highlighted how we saw Scottish Government devolved administrations being involved in the definition, the negotiation, the implementation of those trade deals. The UK Government has been very unhelpful with regards to working with us on those aspects. So the opportunities for scrutiny of those deals are very, very limited. So what that means is, as you said, the deal could evolve and change, and the implementation of it would be something that would therefore have to be taken forward. And UK Government ministers, through this process, give themselves powers in that area that impinges on devolved aspects.
Thank you.
Thank you. And a question that is to be linked to Ms Hislop's. So the Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee, they have written to the UK Government. One of the questions is around Clause 1, which is expected to be repealed once the Procurement Bill comes into force. Could you maybe just say more about how those two interact? And if we're spending all the time trying to get the changes in the Australia Trade Bill, is what bits will be repealed? We need to get it, really, the procurement is the one that will remain, and it's likely to be aspects of that that will be repealed. Is that correct?
Yes, the Procurement Bill, to some extent, will supersede this, and officials can talk to that in a minute, but it's the same concerns on both of them. So yeah, they both come to us at this stage. It's the same concerns on both of them. So clearly we're not comfortable with either of them.
Do you know when the timescale, if one's going to be repealed, what the timescales are attached to that, when the Procurement Bill will be the one that supersedes?
The Procurement Bill is in the Lords at the moment. Uh-huh. I would expect the Australia-New Zealand Bill will proceed on a faster timescale. There's a slight difference in the two powers. In relation to Australia-New Zealand, it allows for implementation of those agreements, which comes in two parts. It's the implementation of equal treatment obligations, and it's some minor amendments to the procedural rules for procurement. The plan that the UK government has is that the Procurement Bill, when it is enacted, will repeal that power because it will no longer be needed. The alternative power in Clause 83 of the Procurement Bill is a narrower power in that it only allows for the equal treatment obligations. It doesn't allow for procedural rule changes. So if there were rule changes required as a result of other international agreements, they would need primary legislation again. But yes, this underlines the point. That's why we were not particularly clear why the power in this bill needed to cater for future changes to the Australia-New Zealand bill when the plan is that it will be repealed possibly within a year.
OK, thank you. Michelle Thompson, did you wish to...
I mean, I suspect it's already been covered, but as part of your concern about precedent, by getting this on the record, even if it's subsequently changed a year down the road, it establishes a precedent, and therefore that precedent could be used for other kind of potential disbenefits in similar trade deals, such as this, given the GDP figures you outlined at the start of your statement, Minister.
Yes, well, I mean, this has come before us to make a decision on legislative consent, and as it stands, we wouldn't agree to it. So I think, if it gets superseded by something else in future, that's as may be, but that doesn't mean that we would give consent just because it's not going to be around for very long, potentially.
Okay. Thank you. Do you have any, Graeme Simpson?
Yeah, thanks. Minister, what are the devolved areas that you're concerned about?
Well, in procurement, because it allows UK government ministers to have scope to make changes, as I've said, to decisions that the Scottish Parliament, Scottish Government Acts of the Scottish Parliament with regard to procurement.
So it's just procurement?
Well, there are broader implications as well, potentially.
This bill is just procurement.
Yeah.
Okay.
Okay, any other questions? Nope, thank you. That brings us to the end of the evidence session on the LCM. I thank the Minister and his officials for joining us this morning and for consideration of this LCM and the other LCMs we've discussed. I will now propose that we make a slight change to the agenda. We can move into, if members agree, we'll move into private session for agenda item 8 before we open up again for our final panel of witnesses. If members are happy to do that. So I move into private session.